All right, it is September 7th in the year 2024, and the sea caves have been on the seafloor in Goleta for 5.5 months, and I'm headed out with my longtime buddy that I started out fishing with in 1984 on the Lynbrook, the Aquarius, and the Speed Twin, and then later the Grande and the Pegasus. Long career fishing with Dion Dante, the one and only, and the kelp will be to the surface by now, and it'll be loaded with bugs. More later.
Hello, fellow fish reefers. This is a top-down look using sonar where you can see the kelp on the 16 sea caves deployed in March of 2024. And here's a school of sardines flipping around right on the surface. That is an incredibly good sign for ocean health in the area that the small bait fish have made the sea caves their home.
All right, here we are on the happy hours of Captain Dion Dante off Isla Vista. September 7th, 2024. Let's go have a look.
It's great to have the support of the local commercial fishing community, and the kelp is almost to the surface, and it's at least twice as thick as the last time it was when we were here just a month ago. There's small rockfish. Instead of individuals, you're starting to see schools of the salmon grouper or the boccaccio, which were once a listed species, and they're clearly using the sea caves to escape predation and grow and become breeding size rockfish. And what do we have here? The Goleta Kelp Restoration Reef's very first lobster, Panulurus interruptus, the spiny lobster that ranges from Central California all the way to Southern Baja on the Pacific side, and is a delicious eating animal. It's a beautiful, smart creature at the same time. And here we are, let's head him off at the pass and go around the other hole. The sea caves were designed specifically to make it very challenging for divers to stick their hands in there and actually grab a lobster. It gives the lobster the advantage. As you can see, the giant kelp, the Macrocystis pyrophora, the fastest growing plant in the world, is thriving on the sea caves. Oh, there's another lobster. There's about one in every other sea cave right now, and as we get closer to October, I think we'll see a lot more. You'll see some large lobster in here because of the size of the holes are so large that they can walk through. As you can see, the sea caves have not buried or sunk in or scoured in the nearly 6 months that they've been on the seafloor. The most amazing thing is every single one of the 16 sea caves has equal robust kelp cover. It's not spotty. We thought that maybe kelp wants to grow every 15 feet naturally, but it turns out it will grow right next to other kelp plants as long as it has the correct habitat to do so. So it's really a force multiplier. It's a way to really allow the ocean to realize its full potential for kelp restoration. There's also some nice boccaccios and some perch. Growing 18 to 24 inches a day in ideal conditions, the giant kelp sequesters up to 60 times more carbon dioxide than traditional pine tree forests. It is an incredible carbon sink. And the more kelp we have, the healthier the ocean. The more carbon dioxide is removed, the more places for the fish to breed and grow strong. And the argument that we like to make is that when you have robust habitats such as biogenic sea caves, in areas where there used to be kelp or there could be kelp, the reality is you'll have more kelp more of the time. So when you have a shock to the ecosystem like a double El Nino, and a lot of the kelp dies from the warm water and heavy swells, when it comes back, having a multitude of sea caves on the seafloor provides more opportunity for more kelp to come back more quickly when it is in the mood to finally grow again. So it's about more kelp, more of the time. The small kelp that you'll see is Laminaria digitata, that grows about 2 feet long. It grows very quickly. It grows all throughout the year. And then, of course, the large kelp that's elevated by the air bladders is the giant kelp, the Macrocystis pyrophora. And by some counts, has died off as much as 90% in some areas. And even if that's only 50%, it's still quite a bit. So we really have to keep an eye on this and provide as much habitat as possible so there can be more kelp more of the time. There's been a lot of discussion and debate about the right way to restore giant kelp forests or encourage their growth, but it is incontrovertible at this point that sea caves are the leading technology for that to occur. If they're placed in just the right area, they can do amazing things. We have seen that happen over the past 3 years in Baja California and now right here in Goleta. And as we have said since the beginning, that as soon as the kelp is to the surface, we're going to pull the trigger and start the permitting process to permit the entire 65 acres of Goleta Bay and bring back our entire historic kelp forest. And that's going to happen next month when we come back and the water is finally clear and the kelp is to the surface. And then we will start that effort. The holdfasts are grabbing onto the metal rebar eye, which is incredible, and it covers the metal and then grabs onto the marine concrete adjacent to the rebar eye. There's a beautiful shot of the kelp going to the surface. And that hole or tunnel is about 18 inches tall by 24 inches wide, and the water just moves right through it, and the four independent legs help prevent scouring and burying. It's really a deceptively simple, highly engineered design. That's why it's patented in over 24 countries. Trademarks on the names, a lot of intellectual protection, because we put so much into inventing the sea cave and then testing it all throughout the world. As Californians, as Americans, as citizens of the world, we deserve to have our kelp forest back. It's our birthright. It's like the sequoias, the giant redwood trees. What would the Sequoia National Park be without redwood trees? Here's a beautiful blonde or yellow rock crab with big meaty claws. And that's what kelp is to California in the ocean. It is our giant sequoias of the ocean. And the sea caves are an ideal tool to help bring it back. There was once kelp 1,000 feet wide, all the way from El Capitan down to Rincon, which is about a 15-mile stretch. And there's very good maps going back over 115 years that the U.S. Geologic Survey did that shows the heavy density kelp beds that were in the area. And we can bring those back. Here's some more boccaccios, or I like to call them salmon groupers. They're not a salmon and they're not a grouper, but that's what we call them for some reason. There's a nice mixture of species of perch. And thank you for helping ocean life thrive.